important topics in the Python, differences with C, C++ and Java. These things will be always will haunt you, which language you should be proficient with. I have some my reservation about Python also, C, C++, Java, these are the language, and another language is Android programming language like Kotlin or Flutter. These things will come up again and again. JavaScript, which language for what and all. Difference with JavaScript, I'll not much about it. Functional programming concept, this is a new concept which is Python also giving. Like your traditional C programming, it is only a procedural loaded programming. So you basically, you think yourself as a CPU. You more importance given on the computation side. Data is not given that important side. Only some native data is available, like character, integer, floating point. Not the advanced data like date and which is the things are coming up, which is not there. So this native data, and we have to call the function call, and we call function call again and again. That is a procedural programming. That is the still from the earliest programming language, say 60s, 70s, that is a rule. Then there comes the Stroustrup. Will Stroustrup develop the language C++? It is developed in 88, 89. It is one of the best languages. Still, it is very relevant. C++, C without C++ would be very difficult choice. C++ is still a preferred language where you make this kind of, say, executable files. Right now, say, you downloaded some executable IDEs from, say, Microsoft or Eclipse. All are written in, mostly all, even Python libraries, all are written in C++. So, the skill is your C will be enhanced definitely by C++, and C++ a procedural plus object-oriented, both the features are there. Object-oriented programming is more like contrast to procedural programming. Procedural programming is kind of a top-down approach. So as if you are a programming by hand, you build up your function, you call your function, and this procedural programming is very difficult to break up, difficult to parallelize. But another advantage of object-oriented programming, it is a bottom-up approach. So what is this here? We give data and function, we don't call function, we call method. Data and method together make an abstract definition of class, then we make a derived class method, then again you derive class. It is a basically not a top-down, it's a bottom-up approach. What is the advantage of bottom-up approach? Say that you can find similarity in the bottom-up approach in day-to-day interactions with various interactions with the object. So you can see the object, you can design its class, you see the commonality of the classes, make abstract class, then deriving. So it is a bottom-up programming. But the main disadvantage of object-oriented programming is it is not that very good for where high accuracy computations are very required, like in case say seismic analysis or earthquake and weather prediction, where a lot of computations are required. That still procedural programming is much better. Bottom-up programming, object-oriented programming is very good where you are interacting with various objects and all, like your Windows programming, like anything you do the our Android programming or web-based programming, where mouse, interactive, clicking, on-click event, all these things are good for bottom-up programming. This is so what we have learned, we have seen first learned the procedural programming, before that assembly language programming, then the procedural programming, best example is C, then the procedural and plus your object-oriented programming, C++ is very best, still it is one of the best language ever. So unfortunately C++ not in your syllabus. In earlier times the Macout has a C++ lab class in your third year, but it is not. So please go C++ learn. That is a very useful language, and I will tell you the tricks, because at the various online interviews you will be given the choice C++, Java, Python. Definitely C++ will be your choice, and they would supply an ID. You have to do the programming there. The C++ programs will always work faster. So if if the certain programmers comes up with the solution, correct solution, the C++ programmers with the shortest amount of time, definitely. So in any, if you aspire for your employment for say Google, Microsoft, Facebook, so we always try, we always wish that you should get a job there, like Facebook, Google, Microsoft, Amazon, or now is it startups, lots of startups are coming up. So they need a utilities app, the various components. They need a sound knowledge in C++. So C++ will be always your focus, then all your C language, whatever you are learning, your now the data structure class, because I personally believe the data structure class you can learn C. Actually programming language is C class, it's difficult to learn. Your data structure class you can learn C. So you please continue your that C++ programming, any lot of materials are there. Then there comes what is the negative thing of C++? The problem is the pointer concept, because the pointer means they see that it's actually give reference to the your hardware, your memory reference. And that is absolutely any industrial strength programming where you require that security and this thing, they are maybe a little slower. Then the Java score. Java is purely object-oriented programming. It is no procedural programming. It is not there that you can understand if you introduce to Java in your school days, or Java you cannot escape it. Probably you have to do Java in your third year. So Java is not very pure object-oriented language, but it's more towards object-oriented programming language. So you have to create even a main method. You have to create an object of a class name, say. Hello src, I am taking a program, then you have to take it hello src dot java program, you have to declare a class public hello src class extends, you have to public static void main, you have to write this function should be public, it should be static, so and there you have to write just a printf hello world like this. So even a single line you have to write 5 or 6 lines of in Java. That is the main disadvantage of Java. That is the problem is lots of verbose language, which is very difficult. The Python is another way. It is, it gives both. It's a procedural programming like C, C++, and also object-oriented programming. It gives both. So that way the Python is very good, but there is pros and cons of Python. Python is very good, not a written it, your a whole application runs on your computer. The Python is very poor. It can do it, definitely it can do it, it can do, but it is very slow. The best alternative would be definitely C, C++, which you know that you should run the software on your computer. Now, whoever nowadays have his own computer, other than computer science students, I know that some people also not touch their laptop or desktop. Very rarely they all serve the purpose on mobile. So definitely, and you cannot always carry your laptop all around the town, all around your whenever you travel. So you always have a desire, should have an application which can be run on your from your desktop and can your mobile. Then the best programming environment should be your Python. Your Java will not be a great choice. Definitely C, C++ is a great choice. So that is the frustrating. I have not shifted Android based app or iOS based app. It's start from the web app, so that the web app, one good point is you can run the web app from your desktop and you can run the web app from your mobile. So that's, and depending on the current environment, the screens and everything's very good. Now this web app, the front end, now it's almost 99% true that it should be written in JavaScript. JavaScript is a scripting language. It is hardly any similarity with Java. It is basically scripting language. What is scripting language? It's like HTML kind of thing. HTML give you the fonts, bigger fonts and all this. How to make animation, JavaScript is best. Some options. So security is less, because JavaScript is mainly developed for say your front end animation, and code is built into the HTML page, and definitely that is visible for any hacker and all these things. So all the business logic, password and all these things, it will be done through secure socket layer, HTTPS protocol and backend always it will be done by either by Java or by Python nowadays or PHP. So where we can land up with our Python knowledge will, if you want to dream a, every, I have told in my previous videos that every student of every faculty or every, whenever you are in third year, second year, right now, whenever you are in a final year, you should have an app on your name, an Android store or iOS store, because developing app and deploying is less, very costly. It's only 1500 rupees you can deploy, and then you can take proud of it. People will know you. We can say this is my app before interview and all these things. So Android app development and iOS app development, this is a excellent choice. And another good point of it, nowadays you do not have to have to separately develop an app. If you take the help of the Kotlin or Flutter, these two different languages, that is a language for developing app development, and you can simultaneously develop the app with Kotlin and with Flutter, to your web app and your iOS and Android. You don't have to maintain different programming environments. So that is the logic. Then the Python JavaScript should be the front end, your front end animation, and back end everything can be done by Python. That is great. Java can also do. That is there are main competition with Python with Java now. Till in the industrial framework nowadays, say in what the service oriented company, whatever our prior students, our ex students are there, till Java is still supreme there. So whenever say all the banking software like Infosys banking software runs on our all banks, from State Bank or Punjab National Bank, this is a famous banking software Infosys has written. They are all written in Java, and Java has full-fledged facility for backend. Python has also, but definitely Java is much stronger there. Java is very superior there. But Java is difficulties. Java, you probably, you know, you should appreciate it. Static typing, it is not that good for machine learning. Huge data handling. Python can handle much more bigger data than Java, because main reason is choice of is data type, because its data types are not static. The advantage of static is everything you can check at the compile time and the runtime, less problem. But disadvantage is that in runtime you cannot change the data type. That is one. So we'll come to it. So the basic things I have discussed. Why you should stick with C and go ahead with C++, because only fixing with C, only C based job, only C, it doesn't help, because if you write a big code in C, much bigger, difficult. But if you can learn C++, standard template library and all, that's great enough. So that is one. And Java is for training. You have to learn it in your finally in your second year, subsequent year, and Java is still the dominating industry, because most of the service-oriented company taking Java. So then the Python, now the trend towards this, the machine learning and all these things, these companies are taking project, they want the Python, but only Python doesn't help you. You should know how to use the Python to make an app. So that is my prerogative to you. Basic, other than the syntax, I want to tell you, please, development app and the front end should be a JavaScript, and there you have to learn little about HTML. That is, I found the wgschools.com is very good introduction. Within a half an hour you can learn HTML, cascaded style sheet. HTML means your font size, cascading style sheet means your range of pages, what should be the background and all these. This cascading style sheet basically. Then the JavaScript, and nowadays you can put your JavaScript full code into an HTML page with the tag script and end tag / script. So script is universal. It is works on your mobile phone, your Android phone, your iOS phone. No, so anything in your browser, it's operational. You can write it in JavaScript. So that's it. Another concept which is coming up is it is still there from 80s, because from AI language, artificial intelligence, the functional programming concept, that is completely missing C, C++ and Java, but we have it in our Python. So Python is basically a pop out of a language. Here you have, you can have to select various types of programming concept and Python language I've discussed. So let's go quickly whatever we discuss. Yeah, this is a data structure in Python. What is, I want to think, first thing, anything data structure you're learning from any language, always you see whether it's mutable or immutable. So in our C days, in your C programming, everything is mutable because memory is very precious at the time. Now the problem with mutable that it takes slower. So immutable, you can quickly because whenever an array is immutable, size is less. Whenever array is mutable, size is bigger because you have to keep reference and pointer, all these things. So mutable is much quicker in hand. Immutable is very quick. You can handle in memory and all these things. So immutable is the preferred choice. And you know the in Python everything is immutable except list that you know and dictionaries. Because dictionaries you can always add data, delete data. List is that. Set is also there. These are mutable data, and all the basic data like your say integer, floating point, which are very basic, which are immutable. That is gives a Python a great advantage. And string is immutable. Tuples are immutable, that you all know. And you know the this advantage of immutable data. There's dictionary. You can put as a index. And what is the great advantage of your associative array? Associative array means you do not give the address. I'm staying in Dom Dom Park, and I give a direction. I don't give the actual address of my address here, say it's 35, because here the in various places the house numbers are not arranged properly. See, if you go to AGC Post Road, the famous circular, lower circular road, and there on the right hand side you get all the your odd numbered houses 1, 3, 5, 7, and on the other side you can get it 2, 4, 6, 8. That is very planned. So even it is 100 years back, maybe the English people have done it, but it is very planned number. But if whenever you get the your house number, you always know which side of it. So you can cross the divider with the big road, and that is a beautiful numbering I found. That is, you call the referencing by an address like in an array. But if it is in my place, it is a circular, because in one line it is 1, 2, 3, 4, then it goes sometime, then it comes 7, then it comes 11, 12, 13. So it is very difficult to predict on which side of the road your house will be, because it is but again, a good advantage is we have many ponds here. Every pond they've done it in clockwise. The increasing is clockwise, I found it. So there is various ways you can house number. And say if you stay in, some people stay in North Bengal or in maybe distant location, there you might see there is no house number. Even if it is there, they always mention that the pond number 1 to pond number 2 in Dom Dom Park, tank number 1, tank number 2, or besides Kali Mundir, all this. This is called content addressable memory. Content, that is, we generally humans are doing that. We are in our memory, we do not have reference 0001, 0002, 0003. We know we generally, whenever we meet you, we try to fix you, whether it's a boy or girl, or whether it's tall or short, like this. Even if we are not, our subconscious is a content addressable memory. That is a good thing, is a dictionary can do, where your C, C++, Java doesn't do. So that is a great thing, a dictionary. We'll use a dictionary in the fullest sense in the machine learning and all these things. Dictionary, the restriction is only the key value is immutable, like any other data types other than list or another dictionary. But yeah, dictionary on the right hand side, you can put another dictionary. Dictionary can contain dictionary. That is a good thing. So that is a content addressable memory. That is more intelligent things like we do. Why I've given examples of the array with the 0, 1 index, because we humans do not like 0, 1 index. It is helpful for computer, but the nowadays language should be more intelligent so that we can put our thought process into language. So we need a content addressable memory, that is associative array, that is a dictionary. That is a great thing. Yeah, this slide I used to say later. that one. That is, I have already discussed in various ways. Not every time the algorithms can be found. It is true that everywhere we generally, like today I am taking class, not an algorithm. We have a routine. I just come in and do. This is the algorithm can be various. It may be recursive algorithm. Next example will be factorial calculation or Fibonacci number calculation, divide and conquer algorithm. Lot of divide, mostly all our whenever Google is working or Facebook is working, they divide and conquer. Say whenever any problem, they chunk it, they divide it, and they put the data in various concurrent processor. They come up data, they store it, again divide it, again conquer it. It is another great example. Divide and conquer is very, very, but it is a bottom-up approach. It is not top-down approach. Dynamic programming, I have discussed with you. Divide and conquer means your whole problem set, you distinctly divide it and no overlapping. Dynamic programming overlapping can be there, and it is very helpful for factorial calculation, because all the previous factorial, if you put in a table, then you don't have to go every time, you have to go the fresh factorial calculation. The dynamic programming is very good. So this kind of algorithm, your C, Java, Python give the advantage. Greedy algorithm, sometimes greedy means you try to get the best solution first. Sometimes it has been found that best solution is not always the best. You are putting in a corner so that you cannot come the best solution. So greedy algorithm, non-greedy algorithm, brute force, that I am doing right now, just come in and taking a class. Backtracking, I brute force, I go there, and if it fails, it come back. So these all different, there's other various types of various algorithm, but you should be aware of algorithm. Actually, before solving any problem, you should select which hardware it will run, whether it will run on your PC, then C++ is the best enough. And if you are not sure where it will be run, maybe on the, you have to run it on a Google Cloud Server or Microsoft Azure or Amazon Web Server, then Python, you can think of Python, Java is a good choice, because you can get all your development environment and all these things, it will be there. So what you will do, you download a good IDS, Microsoft Visual Studio is a great IDS. The next day I will take a run some Python programming on but I have already done in JetBrains PyCharm. JetBrains PyCharm is also very good in for Java and Python, but that's not very good in C++. Microsoft Visual Studio is very good in C++ development. You have to learn only one, you have to download only one IDS. You can develop code C++, Java, Python, everything there. Then these are free. These are our community edition. You don't have to pay price. And then our Eclipse is also there. Eclipse, you can run C, Java, Python. This is also free, this is also community edition. So I suggest you please, and then the Google Colab is always there. If the data is very huge and it may need 14-15 GB data, then you can you dedicated one Gmail and put your data into Google Drive, because you should get 15 GB free data. You put your data there, then Google Colab in Python is a great help. But we have found it. Have certain limitations are there, because you need a constant network activity and all these things. Anyway, this is, I already discussed, because basically our Python is basically no dynamic but very strong. What this is very dichotomy. It can be dynamic and strong. Yes, Python is there. It is not dynamic and weak. What is means the dynamic? Dynamic means you can declare at runtime, but once you have assigned a runtime data type, you cannot put it easily to another data type. That JavaScript can do. So if you put you put some integer variable into the Python data type, and now you're just putting it to the screen with the plus, it will not do. So it is a strong dynamic. So that's it. So that will help the Python is data is very reliable, and that because it's dynamic, it is always lazy, because a lazy laziness is always good. So you can ultimately binding at the last minute. So it's a dynamic. If you call programming from call API call application programming interface from any other program, the this dynamic nation's health, but it should not go hang on other things. So it's also strong. So you have to knowingly take data and make a casting, coarsing the data. So Python is very good. Your Java, C hash, C++, all this come this way. So Python, we just focus on Python here. JavaScript is basically a glue type of language on the front end. So it has to be very dynamic and has to be weak also. So it, because no business logic is computed whether your age is, whether you are born on actually in 2001, first March like this. This checking is not done JavaScript at the front end. So it can be weak also and dynamic also, because you have to be very fast for getting gaming experience, because most of the games front ends are written in JavaScript nowadays. So JavaScript, Python is always a good combination. You don't have to learn any other language. If you want to make app application, then maybe Kotlin or Flutter. So next slide. This is a difference between Python and C++. This just I got it. Nothing is much. Rapid prototyping Python is much helpful. Rapid prototyping C++. Rapid prototyping. We quickly develop a solution. And nowadays, a software life is very important, because say right now the COVID Omicron virus has come. So you have to tackle Omicron virus. We all know that after 5 months, maybe another virus will come. So if we make a software for Omicron virus, we know we have to quickly develop it. We cannot take 3 months to do it. So we have to make software development, maybe for Omicron virus specific app and all these things within a week or maybe days. So then the Python is much helpful. Nowadays the problems, because you know they're aware of this virus and the nature, like it is temperature rising and all these things. So we need to have quickly act, and we cannot think a traditional way that we can have a big computer at your home or big CPU. So we have to see that our app should run on your mobile, because nowadays whenever you go, you can have to carry one money bag and mobile, or even without money bag, because all the Paytm, all the payment solution on your mobile. So you, generally we people at your age or even in our age, always we carry mobile. Because not only that, mobile, all WhatsApp, you can call your brother, sister at US and any place, free, almost free. So you should have only a data and all these things. So mobile is essential, and because it is essential, you can have app built into it. So there the Python can be great here with the JavaScript, okay, and the Kotlin or this thing. So my whole focus is taking to you, to motivate to you, please try to make a small app like this. Okay, so let's go to I already discussed this. Python is mainly made for, we have taken a class at TK Intel, because we generally front end we wish to develop in JavaScript, so we can have less stresses here. We have already covered NumPy. Sarah has already covered, because what is NumPy? I have already covered visualization, Matplotlib and SNS. That is good. Natural language processing, NLTK, I have not covered. I wish to cover one day. The game development, Pygame and all these things. So these are very interesting. Scientific computing, NumPy. This is, we always see the vision of the man, William Henderson, because he at that time visualized, and the great thing he visualizes that no indentation, taking as an indentation as a marker in the language. Because my experience, I have found it. Whenever I know the, whenever I take the data structure class in C and basic C class in lab, when the lab is actually, it is very difficult to find the bug in the student program, because the reason is that every student, they put their own indentation and the logic is different. So learning indentation of the particular student and correcting it, the second bracket should be bracket, and that is also C never enforcing that. You have to put it many books, the second bracket comes on the right hand side and second bracket at the closing second bracket at the left hand side. That is looks nice, but for matching it is difficult. You have to count it that opening braces and closing braces should count same, and it should be inserted a tab. So I found it in C that opening presses and closing presses should be at the same level, and the code should be at least 4 characters within the that. And then the anything function, again opening presses, closing presses, like Python 4 characters. That will help the you understand any problem with the your syntactic error. They call the syntax error and all these things. So C doesn't say anything, but Python has said that you have to have give 4 characters. It always is mentioned 4 characters, and if there is no such semicolon, so it will already declutter, because we generally every day our prose we do not semicolon so often in like C or Java. So that is one good thing. We are coming both towards your what day to day you read in newspaper and all, no first second bracket opening second close. So only colon is there. So Python is great in the, that is a great change. That is the readability of the code. That is Python is great. So ready. So this is I already told that Python that is immutable type. You focus is immutable type. It is faster. Mutable type least dictionary set. A dictionary can contain dictionary because it's immutable. It can contain dictionary, can contain dictionary, least key content, least, and all these things. And the main is dictionary. One advantage is the content addressable memory. Nothing similar things is not there in Java. At least you have to incorporate other libraries. Yes, you can C++ and Java. You bring some third party libraries, but Python is built in. That is great. This is, I think, nothing much. Just nothing much. This is you dynamically. I already told semicolon not needed. So codes are shorter. That is, you can read the code better. Productivity is great. So that's it. But Java is traditionally strong with the backend activities. Python still that level of Python main stack is only Flask. And Django, we try to cover both this. I've already Flask and Django is a Python backend, but JavaScript. Java does have many good stack is working. So from Oracle, it is supported by Oracle. So until industrial level, the Java is a language at the service oriented architecture. Java is the language. This I've already told. This I have already covered in my this thing. This is obvious. So. This is just because this lecture should not take your brain. So this is the dictionary concept, and you always remember there's always a quiz. If we give a second bracket opening and second bracket closing, nothing in it, that is not set. That is a dictionary. So any blank entry is a dictionary, not set. You know this second bracket opening and second bracket opening can be set also. And here is immutable things. Nothing else. The dictionary can contain dictionary. This thing, yeah. That I have told. Static and Java Python is dynamic and strong. Advantages there. Data types. This is almost covered. This is covered. Variable cannot change type. It can change. This is. I wish to mention that this is. Beautiful template of class. Whatever you see, class that is a class is a keyword, and colon is always used in function call and all these things. This is a constructor in Java that will confuse you. They have a constructor the same name student, then you should be confused that why same name, and there may be overloading of the constructor, maybe with one parameter, two parameter. The student with one, the initial constructor student with one parameter, student with two parameter, the code will be lengthened and it will confuse the programmer. So Python developed earlier, that is a smarter route. The constructor they always called it double underscore int and double underscore, and all the overloading can be done here. That is it. Yeah, that is it. And always you make a class or any definition, you should at least one line. That is an should be 4 character. So I would request you please follow as Guidi van Rossumhout has defined that way, then it will be better to understand your code. Yes, this is a very interesting thing. I found it in exception handling. C doesn't have any exception handling. Always say return 0 means is everything is okay, and if anything wrong, so you have to code it return 1, return 2, return 3 in C code. And I have already mentioned that always C function main should be int, not void. So because if it's void, you cannot know what happens. So it should be int main, then you can last statement should be return 0. If there is some, you cannot create a file, then you say return 1. That means 1 means you cannot create a file. Any other place, say if you have any other thing, if you return 2. So that way from return, you can get it the your what happens to the program. So but it is much better in Python, because I also said Python came much before, one at least 1 or 2 years before than Java. Java is also good. There comes on the exception. Then the different error they visualize and how the exception should be handled. So if you think that this program, say if you write a data file to a pen drive, your pen drive might have some issue with space, then it can throw an exception. And when in C program, that will come out of the program and say I stop. But in Python, Java, you can always anticipate, and what else to be done, you have to write it here. This is a if condition, but same concept is there in try catch block. So same thing here, if condition, last should be else, okay, and nested if it can be elif, and last else should be attached. This is good, but this you can use it. Our try catch block also looks similar. I hope the next statement is, I'll come this if any, this that slide will come. This is object oriented programming. It's a bottom up approach. I have told you the difficulty of object oriented programming is for a simple thing you have to elaborate class framework and all these things. That is negative thing with procedural programming and another programming style, functional programming, that is Python also giving support. Best example is the lambda and the decorator function. Lambda, I have discussed decorator in my earlier video. So these are the two functional programming tools. I will come to this. So this is object-oriented programming. We know this object-oriented programming will be more introduced to Java class. The basic starts from inheritance. Inheritance and abstraction go hand in hand. So you define a class, it could be abstract, then first is abstraction. First is abstraction, then inheritance. First step is abstraction. You can make abstract, then maybe abstract class, then inheritance. You extend the class. The first step abstraction in inheritance, then abstraction and inclusion together, and definitely, and the polymorphism mean method name is same as implementation different. These three together is object-oriented programming. This is class, this is a constructor, the same name in the Java, and the object. You can, so that you don't have to write every time various types of cards. So we can get it from there, do some modification and all these things. Global data. The procedural programming, one problem is always global data is required, and there is always the generally programs is not written by one programmer, it may be a group of programmers. You would not believe, say Windows 10, maybe it is written all over 20 years, maybe average 2 lakhs of programmers, so they are always using the code. So if it's a global data, the unknowingly some corruption can go, and very difficult to debug data. In object-oriented programming, the data is taken within the object, data become private. So object-oriented programming is good for running it. It's more scalable. It's more scalable means you can, if you run a program for 10 users, you can run the program in 100 users, 1000 users. Object-oriented programming is better because here data is much more secure, and anything you operate data, you need password and all these things. So the global data concept is less there. These are the two main style, both you can follow in Python, mix and match. That is strength of, that is Java, you cannot handle procedural programming. I have told you, in procedural programming, certain computation intensive job, procedural programming is much better. So this is some pictures, so you all know that frozen state. Frozen set can be used as immutable. It can use as a just method called frozen set. You can use as a key. immutable. So it's a typical question asked, what is the difference between state and processing? Yeah, this is if condition, you know, that is great. So like all the things, is colon is very vital. You should don't miss colon. And here the colon is the class definition, function definition, and the colon is a marker. You should miss this. Is that always the four characters? Yes. There is this is the concept of functional programming. The functional programming, your functions taken as a basic data type, and you, if it's one, if you can put it in one line of function, if you just put it lambda function, like here lambda function say a star a, but it is just give an example. If you can put it in one line, and then your code would be very less. If you put it in a definition of function left, like I suppose a def, def product colon, then body of the function one line, so maybe 50% code will be less with this lambda function. So that is not giving the Java, and that is your code will be reduced, and the lambda function will be only that time you declare and use it, throw it away. So readability of the code is, it must be one line expression. Readability is much more better. That is another picture. Lambda function, like in lambda keyword, this is a keyword. This is the colon. Colon is very vital in Python. And these are the parameters. This can be overloaded. It can be overloaded. Expression and all these things. It should be valid Python expression. Pandas, I have already declared. It is when you are learning now NumPy. NumPy has some problem with the data. If the data is not matching, if the certain data is not there, the NumPy, you cannot load the data in Pandas. So Pandas is very great. If certain particular data is not there, say you have to put a full Excel table of your class, maybe some people have missed the class test, or maybe some people have left your class and come. All these things in NumPy, it sometimes give problems. So you can put the data in the Pandas. Pandas is very machine learning, that is one of the must. And these are the various type of data, you know, categorical data. This concept is not there in C, C++, Java. You know, nominal is I am the king, sort of. Ordinal means if there is some order in the data, excellent, good, bad. This ordinal data, nominal data that every day we know, that's it. This is the data frame. This is the typically in your RDB means you see the data is stored in a row wise, and in now modern day database NoSQL, data will be stored in column wise, and column wise data will take less space, and you can put in picture and video and all this is column wise data. So they save it as a column wise. This column wise data type should be same. So you cannot match, like list, unlike list, you cannot as integer, you cannot float, you cannot have ASCII, but you have the same nature. It is a NoSQL type of database. So this is rows and columns. In RDBMS, rows, they save the data in the row wise in a database, and that will take much larger space and difficult to retrieve. But in this kind of data, like modern day MongoDB, particularly DBMS is free, you can use it in your app. So if you want to put data in, not in MySQL, MySQL is RDBMS data, in MongoDB you can put data in the type this form, in the column. Column should be of same type. Yes. This is, I have already Pandas, the NumPy array, Pandas data frame. Basically Pandas is consist of NumPy, so anything NumPy can do, Pandas can. That's something you should be aware. Advantage, I have already told, nothing much here. Python versus procedural, that I already discussed, this procedural and object-oriented programming. This is a definition of your function, that is important. This is a constructor. This is in self, in Java it is called this. So self is a keyword. So you are initializing your variable by self.radius and self.color. In those who know Java, that is the same thing, and constructor is the same name, but here is the underscore init underscore underscore. whenever I see underscore underscore, these are all private variables, private function. How to define a class in Python? I have already covered. Define a constructor. Yes, this is a method, returns a method. Good. This I have already covered. The matplotlib. One good thing is matplotlib runs everywhere. Your Unix machine, Windows machine, various kinds of plot, line plot, scatter plot. Scatter plot is good for machine learning. Histogram, bar chart, pie chart, everything. Matplotlib, and another is SNS. Both I have discussed. And this is the area. If you can, this is the scripting area, scripting, and this is Matplotlib. This is Matplotlib, which is backend architecture of Matplotlib. Issue. This is a Python range. This is interesting slide I found it. Range should, even if the range is given 171. It should not touch 7. See, before 7, it will stop at 6. So that is interesting. And step is 1. Step comes here. So you should range 6. So it will go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, like this. So this you can remember. Sometimes difficult. Python functions, I have told. This is nothing much. Only the one thing that you should give one line. And the function body, you return this. This is decorator. I have given in my last class. Decorator is a very excellent thing. If you can get your own function, or if you get a function from others, you put something, you before the function, you decorate the function, you put some lines before it and you put some lines below it and use the function and give a name, a new name, and then just use @ that function name in that body, in the function, then it is a decorated function. So that your lines of code will be executed before the function enters there, after this enters there. But you are not changing anything within the basic function, which can be written by you or is a third party. That is a great advantage. So you enhance the performance of a function by writing a few lines above and below. That is a functional programming. That is a new style of programming. Till now we have covered procedural programming and object-oriented programming. Next thing is called functional programming. Functional programming, again, it's a top-down approach. Your procedural programming is a top-down approach, but here is also top-down. It is kind of a declarative thing. So I just call the functions and it will do its job. Data should be separate, like object-oriented programming. Data is tightly bound with the function. It is not. So it is good for parallel programming and like least artificial intelligence programming on Python, they have these features, functional programming. Then we just give declare, then it will be automatically done. It can be done parallel. That is great advantage of this. Decorators I have covered in my last class. This is a just dev grid. I just add my decorator function. This is the function I, then it will be executed. Like I stop it, the function is say hello. And I just end, and then this is the additional thing it will be done. I have to just put my decorator there. There is a function. So you have to write this first and then you put the @ my decorator. This is, I used to cover the Flask is a backend architecture that which can handle the your Python code, and front end can be JavaScript and is great to write web app. This is all HTML5. So here your client end will be only JavaScript, no Python, no Java, no C, no C++. So whenever you are working on a web app or Android app, everything will be run in HTML5 and JavaScript. So there the JavaScript is there. So if you just quickly learn W3 schools from HTML, cascaded style sheet and JavaScript, that will help quickly to develop your web app. This is basic things of HTTP. This is, you can put all your data in GitHub. And GitHub, you know, it's done by Microsoft. So, and in Salesforce, please, with your Gmail or any mail, you can go for Salesforce, you get a Heroku. It's a free client, so you can, web app, you need certain data, certain program should run. Even if your computer is off, it will be running there. So Heroku gives you free storage facility and you have to make it on. So you can you can develop your application from your laptop and desktop. You can run it from web. So Heroku, it's a Salesforce organization. You probably aware Salesforce is one of the top 10 software companies, software product companies. Oracle, Microsoft, all of this. Then Salesforce is definitely one of the product companies. The software as a service they are giving. See, this is a Heroku. This is another RDBMS, free RDBMS like MySQL. Heroku give it. PostgreSQL is a free. That is a relational, call row wise. And Flask is there. Lot of this thing, web client. This thing, Twitter is using. Python, JavaScript. This is UTF 8 or 16 both. Python is indentation here, curly brackets like C, C++. Data types are very limited, putting all of it, make it simple. JavaScript object notation, JSON, I'll discuss definition. This is great for Python, JavaScript, web development, web application, games, online. Python is mainly backing database access. So we try to cover the MySQL database access and PostgreSQL access. MongoDB access can be done with the Python and the backend. It's very great. Python is an all-purpose language. You can do only thing. Limitation of Python is you cannot do on front end. You can with GCHTK, but not that great. That is Python. This is Python functional programming. Functional programming, I've already told you, is a programming paradigm that treats computation as an evolution of mathematical function. Say they think as a more like a your mathematical function. You run the mathematical function together, not you have to strictly programming. We'll see this functional, it is a more declarative. Function is a first class object like lambda declarator. These things will be more clear if I give some examples. I have ready, but functional programming emphasis on doing algorithms. Yes, it's a more top down approach. Object oriented, I told you, is bottom up. Data are functions kept separately, unlike OOP. There's a lot of issues. So data and functions separately in procedural programming also, but functional programming is much better than procedural programming. So, yes, this is with summary slide.